Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Chocolate Maker's Wife by Karen Brooks and read by Willow Nash. This book is for two Stephens. Firstly, Stephen Bender, dearest of friends and mentor. It's also for Stephen Brooks, my love, my life. It is interesting to consider that beverages like coffee, chocolate, and even sherbet, seemingly innocuous to us because they are non-alcoholic, began life in England as dangerous, expensive, and exciting symbols of dissidence. Antonia Fraser, King Charles II. Revenge is a kind of wild justice, which the more man's nature runs to, the more ought law to weed it out. Certainly, in taking revenge, a man is but even with his enemy, but in passing it over, he is superior, for it is a prince's part to pardon. Some, when they take revenge, are desirous the party should know whence it cometh. This is the more generous, for the delight seemeth to be not so much in doing the hurt as in making the party repent. Francis Bacon, On Revenge, 1625. Part 1. May to September 1662. To conclude, if God give you success, use it humbly and far from revenge. If he restore you upon hard conditions, whatever you promise, keep. Charles I's final letter to his son, Charles, Prince of Wales, 1649. 'Twill make old women young and fresh, create new motions of the flesh, and cause them to long for you know what, if they but taste of chocolate. Chocolate, or an Indian drink, translated by James Wadsworth, 1652. 1. In which a young woman encounters four men and some horses. On the 29th of May, 1662, God Almighty and ever-punishing chose to make it bloody hot. At least that's what Rosamund heard Sissy Barnes say as she staggered into the kitchen with a pail of milk. The current of warm air she brought with her caused the other two scullions to moan and flap their aprons at their faces, earning a scolding from Dorcas, the housekeeper, who told them to stop making such a blasted fuss. Rosamund pressed her lips together lest she too be accused of making a blasted fuss, and instead picked up the tray of bread, melting cheeses and coddled eggs to deliver to the sweltering guests waiting to break their fast in the taproom. Tobacco smoke hung thick in the air, punctuated only by the chittering of the finely dressed women who appeared to be competing with each other to see who could be the loudest. As Rosamund entered, one of them lamented in strident tones that the inn didn't provide coffee. A protest greeted with much head-shaking and tut-tutting. Rosamund didn't feel inclined to inform the heavily powdered woman, whose cheeks carried more patches than flesh, that they did indeed provide the bitter, silty beverage, but supplies had run out with the sudden influx of visitors. The women made a point of ignoring Rosamund, holding her responsible for their having to drink ale or sack like commoners, instead of the fashionable new drink fast becoming the rage in London. Their male companions offered her sly smiles and surreptitious winks. One of the so-called gentlemen even leaned behind his lady to pat Rosamund on the bottom. Overlooking this liberty, as she did all others because her stepfather, Paul Ballister, said a man was within his rights to treat a woman any way he wanted, a view Rosamund silently maintained her grandmother, Lady Eleanor Tomkins, would have contested, she replaced the tray behind the counter and waited to see if her services would be further required. The men and women puffed on their pipes, sipped the liquids they claimed to despise, ate the tepid but tasty food placed in front of them and prattled emphatically, usually about whatever they were reading in the news sheets and pamphlets so many of them brought with them from the capital or purchased in town. She'd have to make sure to remove them when they'd finished, lest Paul happen upon them. Poring over the discarded papers that he was too tight to buy himself, he would rail about the rubbish royalist claptrap the cunting correspondence published, then take his anger out on all those around him, mostly her. He never said anything negative about the king within earshot of the guests. He was too clever for that, choosing to nod amiably as they recited snippets from the pages and praise his majesty like the most practiced sycophant. He presented a picture of affability. Looks could be so deceiving. Rosamund rubbed a streak of egg white from her bodice and frowned at the greasy mark it left on an otherwise reasonably clean gown. For the umpteenth time, she wished she could read the news sheets too, especially since whatever was written seemed to incite such passionate conversations and aggravate Paul so very much. A contrary part of her had no doubt she'd like what he loathed, and that gave her a little warm feeling right between her breasts. She examined her fingernails and resisted the urge to chew them. Her mother had warned her that her usual lackluster efforts at personal hygiene were unacceptable while there were so many guests, and insisted she wash her face and hands every night and morning. Pleased to obey her parent in this instance, knowing the additional patrons also meant Paul was kept occupied tending to them, Rosamund enjoyed feeling relatively clean, even if the condition was only temporary. When she glanced at her reflection in the mouldy mirror hanging behind the bar, she marvelled at how pink her cheeks were when they weren't decorated with smut and mud, and how her brows formed neat arches without soot in them. Whereas no one would have given her a second look a week ago, it was remarkable what a little soap and water could do. Tucking a stray lock of hair back into her cap, she was trying to fathom how she could remove the egg stain when she caught a glimpse of her stepfather weaving his way between the tables, bowing in his fawning way to all and sundry. Before he could detain her, Rosamund ducked below the counter and slipped out of the room, keen not to be accused of slovenliness or anything else that might earn her stepfather's opprobrium. She grabbed the besom and some rags and swiftly ascended to the upper floors, wiping the banister as she went, searching for the dust and dirt inevitably trailed inside from the road. The maiden voyage in might be on the verge of decrepitude, but there was no reason for the old place to be filthy as well. Squeezing against the wall to allow some patrons passage, dropping a curtsy and murmuring a God's good morning as she did, Rosamund couldn't remember the place being so full. Why, if they'd been in Bethlehem and the blessed Joseph and Mary had asked for a room, they would have been turned away. As it was, anyone who was anyone, and quite a few with no claim even to that, had left London either to join the king in celebrating his bride's arrival in Portsmouth or simply to celebrate. Rumour had it the real festivities wouldn't commence until King Charles brought his Portuguese wife, Queen Catherine, back to Hampton Court, and would no doubt resume all over again when the court moved to Whitehall. Not that anyone seemed to care. Lords, ladies, courtiers, hangers-on, servants, messengers, actors, actresses, whores by any other name, according to Paul, which didn't stop him ogling each and every one, and canny vendors had spent the best part of the past month rushing from town to country and back again, like bees in a summer field. They drank like thirsty dogs and, as she overheard Mr. Rowan, the night soil man, saying to Dorcas, rutted like Tiffany traders persuaded they were bleeding rabbits, whatever that meant. With all the extra guests came additional duties, and Rosamund didn't mind throwing on an apron and helping the servants they'd employed to assist with the rush. After all, they lightened her tasks considerably. With more hands, they could present the illusion of being accustomed to serving fine people and catering to their peculiar needs and tastes, never mind all the personal servants guests had at their beck and call. Beds for the extra men and girls had been made up in the stables, and two lads even dossed down in the kitchen. There was no doubt her stepfather and mother were enjoying the bounty these sorts of patrons and their coin provided. Her mother donned her best dress each day, fashioned her hair beneath a stylish bonnet, Rosamund was certain she'd seen it atop the head of an actress who'd stayed with them one night about 3 months ago, and, apart from ordering the staff around as if she were a queen in her own right, had arisen early today so she might escort a party of their guests to the river. From there, some would board craft to take them back to London, while others would watch the flotilla of caparisoned boats passing. Even Paul had made an extra effort with his brocaded Sunday jacket, fixing a smile beneath his finest periwig and visiting the barber for a shave. He'd ordered his sons from his first marriage, the twins Fear God and Glory, to bathe, make sure their collars and cuffs were clean, and to assist the ostler they'd hired, an ex-sailor named Avery, who joined the Navy years ago and fought under Cromwell and, after the Restoration, for King Charles too, in the hope it would make his fortune. Fighting for the Lord Protector, he'd enjoyed regular pay, but since the King returned, he hadn't seen a single penny, even though he'd been back from Guinea for months. He'd many a bitter word to say about His Majesty, who could spend a fucking fortune on his strumpet's jewellery, but not see fit to pay good, honest sailors who helped secure the throne as well as new territories for the crown. Rosamund was actually grateful to the King, not for spending the money Parliament granted him on his latest fancy woman, but because his marriage kept her stepfather from noticing her lapses of judgment or finding flaws in her work and using these as a pretext to give her one of his lessons. She tried so hard to be good and obedient, as the catechism she recited for him every day demanded. While she didn't adhere to the rules around cleanliness as much as she probably should, she felt there were good reasons for that, and God in his wisdom would understand. Mind you, spotless or dirty, well-behaved or disobedient, it didn't seem to matter, as Paul would always find reasons to punish her. Thus she'd developed the habit of keeping her ears and eyes tuned for his presence lest he order her into his study and close the door, or find her alone in a corner of the inn or the stables and begin the lesson there. He could be quieter than a hungry cat stalking a mouse, looming out of the shadows and pouncing when she least expected it. However, as long as the inn was at capacity, she was relatively safe from Paul and his sons, who were fast developing the unnatural tastes of their father, and could enjoy the pleasure of warm water and soap and more besides. If that meant the King deserved her gratitude, well, she wouldn't begrudge him a little. As far as Rosamund was concerned, even though these royal hangers-on treated her as if she was the ash in their hearths, she wished they'd never leave. Rosamund wished for many things of late. It was 9 years since her beloved grandmother, Lady Eleanor Tomkins, had died, and she'd been rudely taken from the comfort of Bearwood Manor. She might not have been a legitimate granddaughter. No one, not even the servants at Bearwood, bothered to pretend that her father, the dashing Sir John Tomkins, had ever considered marrying her mother, a mere miller's daughter. But when Rosamond's mother left her newborn bastard on the doorstep of the Tomkins estate, Lady Eleanor had taken her in and cared for her as if she were a rightful scion. Having lost her son to the first King Charles cause, her heart would not allow her to do otherwise, despite, or perhaps because of, those who held firm to the notion that in publicly acknowledging Rosamund, her wits had deserted her. When Rosamund remembered those days, days when her laughter rang through the house and grounds at Bearwood and her ready smile brought answering ones from everyone around her, she also recalled she'd never had cause to mourn her state as a bastard. On the contrary, she revelled in the firm love and many kindnesses proffered to her. Lady Eleanor might not have shown a lot of affection, but she took care to instill in her granddaughter good manners, an appreciation of her position and the rudiments of an education. Alas, this was short-lived as, upon Lady Eleanor's sudden death, the mooring securing Rosamund to her life at Bearwood came adrift. The mother she knew only from dreams and had been forbidden to mention sailed into her life. Tilly Hobson, Miller's daughter, had become Tilly Ballister of the maiden voyage inn. Respectable, married, and, after taking the payment promised her, prepared to be what she had once denied, a mother to Rosamund. Tilly and her husband, Paul, brought 8-year-old Rosamund south to Gravesend and put her to work. Barely given time to draw breath, let alone become accustomed to her change of circumstance, Rosamund went from being waited on to doing the waiting and wishing. Sissy always reckoned wishing was a waste of time, but the cook, the widow Cecily, told her to ignore silly Sissy as it did no one harm, and if it made you feel better, then wish away because you never knew when God was listening and would grant one. Figuring widow Cecily might have cause to know, Rosamund kept wishing. Often late at night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.